Good morning. As you can see, I have these two rubber balloons, which are attached to one another via this string and hanging from this paperclip currently. What I'm going to do now is I'm going to remove the two balloons from the paperclip, and I'm going to take this piece of fur and I'm going to rub the fur against the balloons. So again, rubbing the fur against the balloons. Okay, so one so far, but I'm going to switch. And now I'm going to rub the fur against the other balloon as well. So now that I have rubbed the fur against both balloons, what I'm going to do is I'm going to rehang the balloons from this paperclip, and you will see. And now you can see that the two balloons are repelled from one another.
Oh, that's neat.
Wow. Sure. It's cool.
Flippin' physics.
Billy, please read the problem, and Bo, please translate.
Two 0.0018 kilogram balloons each have approximately equal magnitude excess charges and hang as shown. If theta equals 21 degrees and L equals 0.39 meters, what is the average number of excess charges on each balloon?
Well, it looks like everything is symmetrical because the two masses are the same, the angle is the same, and the distance is the same. So mass equals 0.0018 kilograms, theta equals 21 degrees, L equals 0.39 meters, and charge average equals question mark.
Great. Bobby, please begin solving the problem.
Sure. We know there must be an electric force between the two charges, the two balloons. That is the only force that could be pushing the two balloons apart like that. That means this problem deals with forces, so let's draw free body diagrams. The force of gravity acts down on both balloons. As I said before, there must be a repulsive electric force acting on each balloon, pushing them apart. And then there must be a tension force acting in each string in the direction of the string toward where the balloons are hanging from.
Because of symmetry, we really only need to analyze one of the two balloons. Therefore, I have only drawn the free body diagram acting on the left balloon. And before we go on, who can tell me what we know about the signs of the excess charges on the balloons from the problem statement?
Well, I said before that the electric forces must be pushing the two balloons apart.
Therefore, the two balloons must have the same sign, excess charge. They are either both negative or both positive.
We know they are both negative because we know he rubbed fur on the balloons, charging them by friction, and we know electrons have transferred from the fur to the balloons, giving them each an excess negative charge.
Actually, Mr. P asked what we know from the problem statement, and it does not say in the problem how the balloons got their excess charge, so we only know they are repelled from one another.
So, from the problem statement, we only know the two balloons must have the same sign, excess charge, however, we do not know if that sign is positive or negative.
Sure, that makes sense.
Very nice. Billy, what do we do next?
Well, we drew the free body diagram. Next, we need to break forces into components. The only force we need to break into components is the force of tension because it is the only force not directly in the X or Y direction. We can draw the vector diagram for that and note that the angle theta we are using here is the same as the one given in the problem because according to the alternate interior angle theorem, those two angles are congruent. Sine of theta equals opposite divided by hypotenuse, or force of tension in the x direction divided by force of tension. Therefore, force of tension in the x direction equals force of tension times sine of theta. Cosine of theta equals adjacent divided by hypotenuse, or force of tension in the y direction divided by force of tension. Therefore, force of tension in the y direction equals force of tension times cosine theta. Now we can redraw the free body diagram. The force of gravity is still down. The electric force is still to the left. However, we now have the components of the force of tension instead of the force of tension. So force of tension in the y direction is up, and force of tension in the x direction is to the right. Next, we can sum the forces in the y direction. So net force in the y direction equals positive force of tension in the y direction minus force of gravity. That all equals mass times acceleration in the y direction. The balloons are at rest, so acceleration in the y direction equals zero. Therefore, force of tension in the y direction equals force of gravity. We can substitute in equations to get force of tension times cosine theta equals mass times acceleration due to gravity. I bet we need to solve for the force of tension because we know everything else in that equation. So force of tension equals mass times acceleration due to gravity divided by cosine theta. I could substitute in numbers, however, I do not have a numbers dependency, so let's not do that. Instead, let's put that equation in our equation holster.
Billy, I like your approach. Let's definitely wait till near the end of the problem to substitute in numbers. Bo, please take it from here.
Well, we have drawn the free body diagram, broken forces into components, redrawn the free body diagram, and sum the forces in one direction. All that is left in our five steps to help solve any free body diagram problem is to sum the forces in a direction perpendicular to the previous direction, which is the x direction.
Very nice.
Agreed. Very nice. Bo, please go ahead.
The net force in the x direction equals force of tension in the x direction minus the electric force, which then equals mass times acceleration in the x direction. The balloons are at rest, so the acceleration in all directions equals zero. Therefore, the force of tension in the x direction equals the electric force. Substituting in equations means force of tension times sine theta equals the Coulomb constant times charge 1 times charge 2 divided by the square of r, the distance between the centers of charge. We know both charges are approximately equal, and we are solving for the average charge. So charge 1 equals charge 2, which equals charge average. Let's just call that charge Q. So now we can reach into our equation holster and pull out mass times acceleration due to gravity divided by cosine theta and substitute that in for force of tension. Sine theta divided by cosine theta equals tangent theta, and charge times charge equals charge squared. So we can now solve for charge. It equals the square root of mass times acceleration due to gravity times r squared times tangent theta divided by the Coulomb constant. Actually, we can bring r out from under the radical, and we know everything in that expression except for r, the distance between the centers of charge.
Right. Now we need to determine r, the distance between the centers of charge. Billy?
Sure. We have a right triangle where the hypotenuse is the distance capital L, and we know one of the angles is theta. The distance between centers of charge is r, therefore the horizontal side of the triangle is half of that, or r divided by 2. We know sine of theta equals opposite over hypotenuse, or r over 2 divided by capital L. Therefore, r equals 2 times capital L times sine theta. We can substitute that into the equation we got for charge, and now it is time to substitute in numbers. Charge equals 2 times 0.39 times the sine of 21 degrees times the square root of 0.0018 times 9.81 times the tangent of 21 degrees divided by 8.99 times 10 to the ninth. And that equals 2.42719 times 10 to the negative 7th, or 2.4 times 10 to the negative 7th coulombs with two significant digits.
Absolutely right, everybody. A couple of things to point out. One, I have decided to use one significant digit, which I will explain why in a moment. And I have converted to nanocoulombs because there are 1 times 10 to the 9th nanocoulombs in every coulomb, which means there are roughly 200 nanocoulombs on each balloon. Now, about the one significant digit. It is important you realize we have made a few approximations in this example. One is that we have assumed the centers of charge and centers of mass on the balloons are in the same location. The reality is that we do not know that to be true, and likely they are not in exactly the same place. That means the electric force likely acts a little bit farther away from the other balloon than where the center of mass is. Another thing is that we have to assume each balloon has the same excess charge. If we do not assume this, then we are left with two unknown charges in the equation, and we cannot solve the problem. I did my best to give the two balloons the same number of excess charges, however, I can only approximate that. Another thing is that the force of tension does not act at the center of mass of the balloon. It actually acts at the location where the string attaches to the balloon. And one more thing is that the distance of 0.39 meters is quite difficult to measure because we are only doing our best to estimate where the center of mass and center of charge is. For all those reasons, I think one significant digit is plenty for this problem.
That is a lot of approximations.
Yeah, it is.
I know we determined the force of gravity between the proton and electron in our last lesson was so small as to be negligible. However, do we know that to be true in this problem as well? Is the attractive gravitational force between the two balloons negligible?
Good question, Bobby. Let's find out. Billy, please calculate the magnitude of the repulsive electric force between the two balloons. And Bo, please calculate the magnitude of the attractive gravitational force between the two balloons. And Bobby, you can compare those two magnitudes to see if the force of gravity is, in fact, negligible.
The electric force equals Coulomb's constant times charge 1 times charge 2 divided by r squared, or Coulomb's constant times charge squared divided by the square of the quantity 2 times capital L times the sine of theta. With numbers, that is 8.99 times 10 to the 9th times the square of 2.42719 times 10 to the negative 7th divided by the quantity 4 times 0.39 squared times the square of the sine of 21 degrees. And that equals 0.00677827, or roughly 7 times 10 to the negative 3 newtons with one significant figure.
The force of gravity equals the universal gravitational constant times mass 1 times mass 2, all divided by the square of r, the distance between centers of mass. The masses are the same, so mass squared, and the square of r is the same as what Billy just said. With numbers, the force of gravity equals 6.67 times 10 to the negative 11 times 0.0018 squared divided by 4 times 0.39 squared times the square of the sine of 21 degrees. That works out to be 2.76582 times 10 to the negative 15 or 3 times 10 to the negative 15 newtons.
Okay, so I can see the force of gravity is probably so small comparatively that it'll be negligible, but let's figure it out. Let's prove it. So the electric force divided by the gravitational force equals 0.00677827 divided by 2.76582 times 10 to the negative 15, which equals 2.45073 times 10 to the 12th, which means the electric force is roughly 2 times 10 to the 12th times greater than the gravitational force.
Yeah, I think because the electric force is 2 million million times greater than the gravitational force, that means you can safely ignore the gravitational force.
I completely agree. Do y'all realize we have not actually answered the question yet?
We determined the excess charge on each balloon.
How is that not the answer to what is the average number of excess charges on each balloon?
We determined the value of the excess charge on each balloon, however, not the number of excess charges.
Right. Okay, so we know charge equals the number of excess charges times the elementary charge, so the number of excess charges equals the excess charge divided by the elementary charge.
So 2.42719 times 10 to the negative 7th coulombs divided by 1.60 times 10 to the negative 19th coulombs per charge carrier equals 1.51699 times 10 to the 12th. Or 2 times 10 to the 12th excess charge carriers.
So 2 million more electrons than protons on each balloon.
Actually, from the problem statement, we only know it is 2 million more excess charge carriers on each balloon. We do not know if those are protons or electrons because we do not know if the excess charge on each balloon is positive or negative.
But we saw him charge the balloons by friction with the fur.
That is not what the problem says.
Okay, fine. But we do not know the sign of the charge on each balloon.
So I do want to point out that going back to the very beginning of the problem, rather than writing Q average equals question mark, we should have written N average equals question mark. Because N, the average number of excess charge carriers, is actually what we were solving for, rather than Q, the charge, the excess charge on each balloon. Okay, one last quick thing to point out is that the masses of the two balloons do not have to be the same to solve this problem. However, when they are the same, the problem is much easier to solve because of symmetry. If the two masses are not the same, the angles are not the same, which makes the forces of tension not the same, which means the electric force is not horizontal and needs to be broken into components, and, well, you can see the problem is more complicated without that symmetry. So that is why we make the masses of the balloons the same in this problem. And honestly, why there is a lot of symmetry in the problems we do, because it makes the math a little bit easier, but the physics is still the same. Thank you very much for learning with me today. I enjoyed learning with you.